anybody listening, so it's not a problem. Mike, those two bulldogs, he left the little Max is now 9.5 months old. He weighs about 50 pounds. He's a beautiful little bulldog. And Winston weighed more than that. He was probably about 3 now. And he was a foster bull for us. And Peggy brought over. She's a friend of Denise Wilkinson, who has a wonderful place called Palmetto Lifeline. He ain't Anyway, we brought him over to the house, and we didn't know if we would be able to keep him or not, but we found an even better place for him to live after about 9 months, and that's it with a friend of Michael Parks, who works in the office of Stanley. Michael, let me look at you. That's Michael. That's it. The immediate past president of the student body at the University of South Carolina. She'll go graduate. And it's clear that life is so funny in South Carolina. Everybody knows everybody, and all of us are ladies. I used to work with Michael's daddy, Jim Parks, when he was a probation officer in the federal court years ago, and I was a U.S. attorney. After that, and I had the opportunity to interview a new clerk for the state grand jury. So there was Michael, there was Jim Parks, and he's there now. He's doing a spectacular job, but that's a real advantage we have in South Carolina. Everybody knows everybody. We're related to so many different people. You can't never find a stranger, which is part of our success. And there was a young lawyer who used to say people would come into his little country office, and they say they got a question about that family. He said, what's that? He said, well, we want to know about under the law, if we're married in South Carolina and divorced in Georgia, are we still cousins? Seeking that tax extension. We still legislative delegation is on that case. They're working on it hard because that may be a big part of this puzzle. But we've had a number of inquiries, and their companies bigger, much bigger than Scanner, multiple times as big. And it seems to us, and Mike Callahan said he's been in all these meetings that we have, or virtually all of them, from the very beginning, because it was important to me and everyone else understanding the key role that the co-ops play in business, in development, and in the lives of people in South Carolina to enter into seeking for solutions without having total input from the co-op within the state. So, Mike, I take this opportunity to thank you. Mike is a real leader, and he knows his business, and has been enormously helpful in all of the meetings that we have. We're going to have more, and not just in me. That tells me all the time. I have two lawyers back at the office working on this. Just about every day, there's not even two of them. And also, we have some other lawyers that are involved, as well as people in the industry. But let me recite some of these figures. You know, the announcement was made after we started trying to get that tax credit, which had been worth $2 billion, and we may get it yet. But after the July 1st announcement, I called a number of companies, names that you know most of them. I had not heard of some of them myself. But this is the way it breaks down. You know that the co-ops buy 70%, Mike, correct me if I'm wrong, 70% of the power from Santee Cooper and 30% from Duke. You know that there was an agreement guaranteed by Toshiba, which is a Japanese company that owns Westinghouse, that is worth $2.17 billion. Santee Cooper and Scanner have sold that guarantee for 91 point, which would have come over time, if Toshiba lived to pay the money. There were rumors that they were not doing financially well either. So that was a good move by Scanner and Santee Cooper to go ahead and sell that $2.2 billion guarantee for 91.5% to Citibank. And Scanner got $1.016 billion, and Santee Cooper got $831.2 million for a total of $1.85 billion from that guarantee. So that's money that's coming to those two entities. It'll come, I think, fairly quickly. Now, for the bad news, that is Scanner has borrowed $4.9 billion on these reactors, two of them. Y'all know the engine can do it. Santee Cooper was 55%. Scanner owns 55%. Santee Cooper was 45%. There's one reactor that had been built some time ago. Santee Cooper owns a third. Scanner owns two-thirds. So one of them is up there working and doing fine, but the two others have now been abandoned. And by the way, we're communicating with those involved. Tell them to be sure to save the architectural and engineering plans, save all the records, keep everything. So if someone does want to buy them and finish it up, they will have all of the detailed work that they need to do to proceed with the Nuclear Regulatory Commission and everything else. They can't just walk away from them and leave them in the rain. Although that happened to UCAT when it was substantial. As y'all remember the movie, The Abyss, but it went down in the ocean, way down, and there's an abyss. Already way down in the ocean, people went down into it. But that was filmed and the abandonment wrapped up in, I think, in Lancaster, Cherokee County. So there's already one up there. Just the other day, Duke filed the final papers to say that they were not going to go ahead with that. But if you want to see what it looks like inside an empty nuclear reactor, go find that movie and you can see it right there. So that's a lot of money. The $4.9 billion that was borrowed by Scanner, they owe that $4.9 billion. Now, this is a private company with shareholders. And shareholders get dividends depending on the profit. But it may be, I know that the executives are trying to analyze all of that now to see how much can be diverted from what would be profit into this debt. And those are the kind of questions that corporations ask. But in addition, the 4.9 is part of the structure. The investors who lent that $4.9 billion are promised an interest rate of 10.25%. So that's the money that is owned. comes out. If the reactors are built, that's one thing. If the reactors are not built, then you've got $4.9 million worth of debt, plus it somehow is going to have to be solved and paid or something done with the Santee County. Now let's look at Santee Cooper. Santee Cooper is a state-owned organization. So it is allowed to sell bonds, which it does. And there's $4 billion worth of bonds have been issued by Santee Cooper. That is in addition to about $4 billion worth of ordinary debt that Santee Cooper has, for a total of about $8 billion. Customers have paid, it's difficult to estimate, but the customers buying the power have paid something like $540 million in on that debt with their power bills over the last few years. That's about 8% on each bill that the customers have been paying on the Santee Cooper bill. On the Scanner bill, they've been paying about 18% is going to that debt. And that's about it at Scanner, that's about $27 per month per customer on the average, however what it is for Santee Cooper. So my question is, what are we going to do now? I tell you, I'm not interested. I'd like to know how it happened, and I'm gathering a good bit of information on how it happened. And we've gotten some reports that were not immediately available, and we had to press to get those reports, but we got them, and that's opened up a lot of information to us. And we're looking for more all the time. I'm not particularly interested in punishing someone. I'd like to know how it happened, and we're getting a good what I want to do is get us out of this hole to see that either those reactors are built or the people get their money back. It's just that simple. Because if you are a customer of a monopoly, you got no choice where to go. You got to buy that power. You can't go get to this company or that company. Only one set of lines coming in your neighborhood, so it's a monopoly. So those ratepayers, those customers, had no choice. And if they're not getting what they can get the power and the reactors that they paid for, then they should get that money back. Just as simple as that. Scanner's in a little bit of a different posture because you had investors investing their money for a profit and didn't get the profit, and you got customers as well, just like the same people. It's a little bit different. But those pieces, what we're trying to do is find a way to piece those pieces together. We'd like to get the reactors built. Why? Because I believe that there is a big, important role for nuclear power to play in the future of this country. And I know that there are 4 nuclear reactors under construction now, or were until just recently. Now there are 2, and that's 2 in South Carolina and 2 in Georgia. Those are only 2 in the country. We're the only 4. That tax credit that was being proposed, the extension, that will only affect them. Nobody else is building nuclear reactors. They haven't been built in 30 or so years. These are the only ones. What that means, one thing, is the people that know how to do that kind of work are the numbers of dwindling. If there's a future for nuclear power in any kind of way in our country in the future, if we have a nuclear component in our future, we need to have people that know how to work on those things. And ladies and gentlemen, you can't just go put an ad in the paper so we need people to come work on this nuclear project. It takes a lot of training and understanding how to do that. By the way, I'll digress for a minute. They do have nuclear welding courses. For example, at the tech schools in South Carolina, we have the best system of technical colleges in the entire world. Most people don't have them at all. And you can go get your associate's degree and walk out and make $75,000 or so. You can go back and get your nuclear welding certificate and go on up to 85, 95, 100,000. There are great jobs out there. But we need to be sure that we have projects because there is a nuclear future for us. We have people who know how to do that work. But also, the power needs of our state are going to grow. As your governor, I'm in a position, have been as lieutenant governor, a little bit as attorney general, to see the interest that people have in coming to this state. And I'll tell you, it's overwhelming, it's enormous. I had a meeting with an international, the Japanese in in Greenville, Best Web, about a month ago. That's a nice hotel, wasn't it? Actually, it's a room. Look at it. And all they were talking about was South Carolina. Everybody knows that it's the southern United States, the southeast, from Texas all the way up through North Carolina and southern Virginia. That's where the great economic growth is going to be in the United States for the foreseeable future. And as people have told me, we've done studies and examined it, South Carolina had no state has more potential than South Carolina. Most of them are lagging behind. That's why we're winning. We're coming in first and second in all of these economic development studies and things that they do. The best of this, the best of this, who has the best recruitment, who has the best business climate. We're always at the top. Us, Georgia, and every now and then somebody else slips in. But it's coming. And it's coming for a lot of reasons. It's coming because of our research universities, which will collaborate with these major businesses. They're doing it right now. We're working on a project with Samsung, which is one of the finest companies in the whole world. Kate and Dawson have some time over there. He did about that, how they do business. They're serious about it. And they are considering entering into agreements with Clemson and USC to put all the research development capacity and talent and innovation in their company and those research universities together. And you know what that means? That means things are going to happen. Well, that's happening all over our state with these big companies. We've also got a great port. The Port of Charleston is deep and getting deeper. And in just a few years, when we finish the dredging, which started last month, we in New York, New Jersey, will be the dominant ports on the Atlantic coast in just a few years. We'll be able to take those biggest boats. Boats that come in, ships that come in with 13, 14, 15,000 container units on. It's unbelievable they can put that many on a boat. But they can do it, and they'll be coming to Charleston. And we have two inland ports. That's the Norfolk Southern Line runs from Charleston up across 85 in Greer, and then on where those truckers can come in and drop the load there. I'll pick one up, and it goes by night by train down to Charleston and saves them 400 miles worth of travel. And we're getting ready to do one today. It will cross I-95. Nobody else in the country has that kind of network. Nobody else. Finest technical college system in the United States, I mentioned a moment ago. We actually have people who will go to China, or they will go to Italy, or they'll go to Germany, and they have done it, and they tell those people, we will come and we will examine your plant, where, by the way, nobody carries toolboxes anymore. They all have laptop computers. You can't find a smudge of grease in these plants. It's different. It's not like it used to be. But our people will go there and we say, we will come and learn how to run your machines, what they're made of, the talents of the people that are necessary, the customs, the traditions, all that. And we'll come back to South Carolina and develop a curriculum in one of our technical colleges created in 1961. We were way ahead of everybody else. We will teach our people, they can come there and they can learn how to operate with that $1 million machine in your plant even before you get here. And that's why they're coming. Nobody else does that. You know what they call it? All these executives, they call this the handshake step. Why is that? They say in South Carolina, when somebody gives you their word, they keep it. They say the people of South Carolina are different. The people of South Carolina are resilient, they're smart, they're determined, they're strong, and they keep their word. And that's why they're coming to South Carolina. That's why we got to have nuclear power. We've got to have nuclear. We need solar. We need all kind of power. But we have got to have plenty of power. And remember, a nuclear power plant is the one that even if the lines get knocked down, it's not going to get swept into the ocean. Unless you're in Japan, and they have a problem there. We don't have that problem. So nuclear power is safe power. Once the thing is built, that fuel will last for years. Don't have to worry about trucks getting there to refuel. All you have to do is rebuild power. If every one of them gets knocked down, I'm sure that Duke and Scanner and these other companies, they can put lines back up in world records. You know, they'll have that power back. So we got to have nuclear power. That's why we don't want to lose these reactors. But if we do lose them, if they're not finished, then the people will have to get their money back. And there's not 1 cent of debt is going to be absorbed by the taxpayers of South Carolina to bail anybody out of this. Not going to do it. So what is the way to go from here? The best way, the only way that Salem of San Tito. It is a highly prized asset. What is it worth? I don't know, but I guarantee you these companies that I've been meeting with, that the names of which I should not recite, but you can find most of them in the newspaper, if it weren't a valuable asset, they would not be coming around South Carolina every day on the phone or in person like they have been. And I mean all a bunch of big ones, many, many times better than anything we have close to us. So, how much is it worth? What kind of package can we put together? Do you want to buy the reactors? Do you want to buy Sandy Cooper? Do you want to buy Stanley? Do you want to buy all of them? Do you want to buy half the bridge and some of them? Do you want the land? Do you want to put solar panels on the land? What do you want? By the way, we're not selling the lakes. We're keeping the lakes. That's what you want to do fishing, don't worry. You can't make any more of it. We're trying to find a way to put together a package that will satisfy all of these important points for the people of South Carolina. You've got to have the power. The best thing would be to have those reactors, because some say we may be able to finish them, but not this year or not next year. Or maybe we'll do one and then finish the other. And if we can cobble together a group or have one entity that's willing to buy, that will have some money that will go to pay off that debt to San Tico, because that's public debt, that's state debt. If we can get that done, that will be a major step. But the only way that's going to happen is if someone else comes side with the money and is able to do it, to absorb it right now. That's $4.9 billion, to absorb that in their enterprise. And over years,